A very good morning to all of you. I want to thank the organizing committee for giving this opportunity to come and just share some of the innovations that we have had in the Nanyang Technical University. I'm going to talk today on two innovations which has been commercialized, and they all to deal with bone tissue engineering. I think if we look at I wanted to start by sharing a story of two young boys. This has been an inspiration, and all of us know that the Wright brothers in the 1870s, they dreamed to fly. And they have taken a lot of risks, and I think innovation involves risks. They flew without parachute, probably broke a few ribs, and their runway is no more than a disused cornfield. And what remarkable innovations have led to the aerospace industries? And I think this is something which I wanted to share. In many top universities, we are challenging our students. It may not be in the case of aerospace in the 1880s. There's no aerodynamics, there's no aerospace industries, or there's no education. And that is precisely that part of innovation, that part of a dream. And in the area of tissue engineering, our dream is to restore tissue to normality, the tissue engineering way, which I want to describe in the next 5 to 6 minutes. There has been a paradigm shift in education. For a long time, we have been training graduates to feed in industries. But I think it is time that we consider training our graduates to lead industry. I'm also the director for the Renaissance Engineering Program, which is an elite number one program in Singapore, which trains students in 2 degrees, one in engineering, one in Master of Management Technology, in 4.5 years, and with 1 year full attachment in Berkeley and in Imperial. So the need for us to consider education from the point of technologies transformers, which is, I think, very much part of the innovation process. In the education part, I think we begin to realize that, hey, this is something very important. We need to integrate many disciplines from engineering, science, business, and also give them a sense of the broad base in terms of entrepreneurship. We all know the next breakthrough will come at an interface of two or more disciplines, and I think which is a very important part for us to calibrate, that it will not come from a monodiscipline, it will be two or more disciplines. And we have also mapped very carefully and audited what the industry needs, and industries require graduates that are broad-based so that they can change over. And moreover, now with internet, it is true. The minute you graduate, the things that you learn probably will be outdated. And then we need students, we need graduates to be analytical, adaptable in skills, compelling in their arguments. This is important. I think for too long, many of the courses do not train our graduates to have a market sense, and then to have entrepreneurship, and eventually to have a person of high integrity. I wanted to share the part that is utmost in my desire in terms of skeletal disorders, and I think over the years there has been tremendous, both in sports, both in accident, cancer, and also aging disease such as osteoporosis. And this has been a tremendous innovation from the universities in Singapore. It was in the 1996 that Professor Chuck Vakenty, who has been my mentor, who showed me this video, and he gave me tremendous hope, and my postdoc, when we spent our time working with clinicians, he inspired me that the innovations that's required in bone tissue engineering requires a partnership between a clinician or a group of clinicians and engineers. If you can grow cartilage, in this case, on the back of a ear of a mouse, what more other organs can we also do it? And that has been the challenge for many of us working in tissue engineering. The tissue engineering concept that we use in terms of restoring tissue to normality, the natural way, consists of taking cells, your own cells, not that of another patient's, combined with perhaps with some growth factors, if it's necessary, seed them in a scaffold which will eventually dissolve into carbon dioxide and water. And we can also make use of the scaffolds as a temporary attachment back to the defect site. So the technology that we develop, the innovations, both of which has a list of patents, and I'm glad that that has already been mentioned by the previous speakers, it has been a technology that developed not by one group, but by at least two or three groups, both in the science, the engineering, and the clinicians together. And in fact, there is a fourth group, that is the commercial partners. In the area of tissue engineering, we wanted to go beyond just the biomaterials, just the scaffold and the cells, but we also go on into the bioreactor, because we know that if we can mimic the physiologic conditions in the bioreactor, we may not need to have so many animals experiments, do we? And I think this is precisely what we have done, which I'll show in the end, one or two slides on the bioreactor technology that we have done to mimic the physiologic body in bone tissue engineering. In our work, we actually have integrated the modality of medical imaging with the biomaterials and the scaffolds. And what we have done is to really create from the very basic foundation in science. If you go do diving, you will find the fact that planktons are drawn, even there's no current, to the coral reef, coral structures, mainly because a coral structure has high surface area, which is a thermodynamic driving force to suck in the cells. For example, in a material science situation, if you scratch a piece of steel and put it in a salt environment, where will corrosion start? It will start at a scratch. Why at a scratch? It is because you created a high surface area, a high surface energy that then promote that kind of thermodynamic driving force to do so. And once we have done that, a scaffold that can attract cells, your own cells, over time the scaffolds will degrade, the cells generate your tissue, and then you replace it with your tissue. There's one aspect which has not been perhaps touched on in the medical area. That's regulatory approval. You need to make sure, you need to ensure complete safety, efficacy. In regulatory approval, there's only two terms, safety and efficacy. And this is the part that Singapore has been fairly well positioned, because I teach regulatory affairs. I have obtained FDA approval for the scaffold so that the surgeons, no surgeons, would ever want to work with you unless they have seen the fact that, hey, this is not going to spoil my reputation. Right? So if there are some innovators in the biotechnology field, please remember the regulatory officers, the regulatory people need to come together at an early stage. I think it's important, I just flipped through some of the slides, some of the regulatory certificate that we got for the scaffolds in combination with both in FDA, in Korean FDA, and even in India, the IFDA in India as well. I wanted to, in view of time, just give you a glimpse of some of the clinical applications. Pardon me, some of the pictures are a little bit gory, and please forgive me too if it be a little bit offensive to you. And you can close your eyes if you feel the fact that the pictures are a bit offensive. We have done a lot of clinical trial in more than 1,000 patients using a technology that can take your medical images, convert it into a DICOM file, then we can rapid prototype, and then we can create a scaffold that fits exactly the skull. And then we can take the cells from your own body. In this case, it can be osteoblasts. In the first example, it is a large cranial defect. And then you can see the fact that these are long-term experiments after 3 years. And the bottom few slides, you can also see the fact that there are other applications in terms of a burr plug for stroke patients and so on. And bear in mind, these are long-term results, not just 3 or 4 weeks results. They are up to 3 years, and most of our results right now are up to 5 to 10 years, mainly to give assurance to the public. And it is important, too, the fact that you will begin to appreciate that there are bone growth, which is an important efficacy that has been described earlier. This is some of the other slides. I won't go through them. This is one case I wanted to share because it was done in India, Bangalore. All right. Nikita came with a huge defect the size of my palm. In fact, this will be the largest cranial defect in India ever done. We did this, we aspirated the bone marrow, And then something happened 6 months later, you can see the 60% bone growth. Could you imagine a skull defect that is as large as your palm? In normal cases, you use a titanium, this will be a permanent non-bone growth, but now there is a possibility. Working closely with distributors, Synchrony is our partner distributors, this is important. If you have innovations, if you do not have a distribution network, it will not also benefit the patients. And we are so glad that you can see the cosmetic is pretty good and so on. I wanted to move towards a bioreactor. This innovation came from one of our PhD students. She gave birth, she's a Korean, she gave birth to two twins. And we said, why is it that in the fetus, it is moving in three-dimensional way, rotating like a gyroscope? And then we found the fact that there is information in terms of fluid flow, in terms of the way we mimic the microenvironment. In fact, we have identified, and we have told some of cell molecular cell biologists, you have fooled us for the last 25 years. You asked us to take the cells from the body, and then you incubate in a 2D environment, in an incubator. That actually has traumatized the cells. And we have found that by rotating it in two axes, it produced significant results. And some of the results, which I want to show quickly, that you can now actually grow stage 2 bone outside the body. This has been commercialized, patented, worked with clinicians, now working with a company to bring it forth. I think to end this part, I thought I would like to share Wallace Carter. Wallace Carter is a philanthropist, he's an engineer, he's donated the whole biomedical engineering department to Georgia Tech in Atlanta. He inscribed on the wall, a dream is not an invention until you made a prototype. So innovations without a prototype can just be a dream. And an invention, if it's not commercialized, have no impact for society. And I thought that was very, very pertinent in the innovative spirit that we are trying to develop in Asia. So with that, let me end by just showing this slide. I was pleasantly surprised that NTU, my university, has been voted the world's most beautiful campus by the American Travel Express. And we welcome any one of you to visit us. Thank you so much.